Welcome to everybody on my YouTube channel again. I really appreciate you watching my channel. So today we will do something unusual, like in a first two video on my channel. Today we will modify this Roland MV-8800 production studio. This is how the Roland call it, which is actually a very nice drum machine and loop machine and MIDI sequencer. And this also has a really nice DAW inside. But I have some really small issue with the unit itself. The one is the noise level of the cooling fan of the power supply unit, and the other one is the speed of the hard disk inside. I'm really not so happy with that, because it takes so long time to load up the patches and the samples and save back the projects when I'm done with the song. And the third one, and this is the real update, like a modification, because in this unit I will install some really interesting device. And maybe you know already from the title of the video. So let's jump to the topics one by one. The cooling fan in this Roland MV production studio, it's a bit louder even my HP Z800 workstation. So definitely I have to do something with that. The other one is the HDD. Originally the Roland MV-8800 came with, if I remember good, like 32 gigabyte or 64 gigabyte of hard disk space. And of course in that time they used the normal notebook kind 2.5 inch HDDs, which is using the parallel ATA connector and protocol. So it's definitely not a fast HDD on a data loading and on a saving. I want to install some kind of solid state drive inside, and not so much solid state drive in a market which is can support me large capacity on a reasonable price, and so on. So there is a few kind of solution. You can buy a small adapter which is convert your S-ATA to normal parallel ATA, and is using some kind of converter chip on a very small board. And another solution is you can install the CF card into the device, and it's also using some kind of adapter. And I bought in the past for I don't know, like €22 or something like this S-ATA to parallel ATA converter, and I tried out in the device, and of course it don't want to work, because there is some deep firmware issue or some deep protocol issue with the serial ATA and with the parallel ATA. It's not really matching together. So the first time I tried this converter, and it really don't want to work at all. Time to time the device is routed me disk error or missing parameters or blah blah blah. So then I tried other HDD from one of my old notebook, which is parallel ATA, and this is also don't wanna work with the unit. So I start to lost myself in this deep hole. So I did a small research, and I find one SSD which is came with the parallel ATA connector, and it's actually this. If you don't know, guys, this is my original hard disk. What is inside is already 128 gigabyte, because I hold a lot of samplers and patches. So as you see here, this Roland MV production studio is using this old parallel ATA connector, so it's not a SATA. So I did a small research and I find on eBay a company who is dealing with importing stuff from China or whatever, and I find this HDD from the ZNO, or I don't know how I can pronounce it. So this is a solid state drive with a classic A parallel ATA connector. And okay, I said, maybe it's so dangerous because it's not a cheap but not expensive. It's around 92 euro including shipping and taxes. So actually on the box is written, it's this box contains blah 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 SSD for using in, and now you have to listen to it, laptop, desktop, tablet PC, mobile PC, POS machines, advertising machines, medical devices and ATM machines, etc. So it's meaning if the ATM machines and medical devices can work with this solid state drive, it's really using the most common protocol and speed which is exist on the parallel ATA connectors. Yeah, this is the solution for your Roland MV-8800. So I want to show you again the brand and the name of this HDD. So if you are looking for HDD replacement in your MV production studio, I definitely can say to you this is really works. I bought other stuff in a media mark store. It's a really neat and nice USB to HDD adapter. This is the brand, this is Sitecom, and the name is simply combo adapter. And what it can do for you, it actually holds three kind of connector, which where you can connect non-normal PC HDD, which is 3.5 inch or whatever. This is normal parallel ATA connector for big drives. And this one here, and this is where it came to me really useful. Here you can, as you see, maybe I can attach it now. Here you can connect your old parallel ATA HDD, and you see, as you see, this is really sturdy and stable, so it's not a loosey connection. And on the other side you have so I have to disconnect everything. So on the other side you have normal SATA connector. So when you connect this to your computer, you can move data between your computer, and it's really useful. It's, and it just costs like $12 or 12 euro or something like this. And no, there is no issue. The unit is working really, really nicely, and really, it's get a speed up around at least 40-60% on a load, and around 30-40% on a saving. So this 92 euro investment to my one of my favorite instrument is really like nothing. So nothing fancy with that, really. You just have to open the bottom of the case. You can find immediately inside the HDD, and you can replace it to this solid state drive. The other issue is the cooling fan. I find this cooling fan is really noisy in my studio, so it's making a lot of airflow noise. And the most common technique to eliminate this noise, if you move your power supply of your cooling fan from the 12 volt to some kind of other voltage range, which can be 5, 6, 3, 4 volts, depend on the cooling fan. And actually, when I replace the HDD, I find the cooling fan is working on 12 volt. And but on a power supply side, I couldn't find this line. So Roland, what did actually, they applied additional panel inside, you will see when I will open it, and they did on this additional PCB a DC to DC converter, which is convert the 5 volt power supply to 12 volt just for the cooling fan. I don't know why Roland did that. Maybe they used in the past 5 volt fans and they changed to 12. I don't know, I don't want to go deeply inside. And interesting, I have other kind of noise which is came always from this MV-8800 when I did high precision recording on 96 kilohertz or 88.2 kilohertz, I always have some dB of really interesting noise, which is time to time is coming, time to time is not coming. It's like a tri tri tri, like a small bug somewhere in a studio. So it's really is just a couple of dB from the 100 dB range, but. You know, guys, I'm a bit I don't know how it's said in English, but I'm really sensitive for the small issues, and when something is annoying me, it's annoying me. So on same time when I did this modification, this noise is disappeared. I think maybe the frequency of this DC-DC converter and the sampling frequency when I did this high quality records, it's maybe came somehow matched together and there is some interference, and this is how these creepy, very small noises came. By the way, it's only came on a TRS output, so it's not came in the headphone output or on a digital output. It's really just came out on the TRS output. So, okay, maybe this is a bit off topic. And the third one, which is the real update and the modification, is it's actually not an issue. Just I changed a couple of months ago all of my MIDI connection and MIDI system in my studio to some kind of Ethernet-based MIDI, which is called Copperlan. You will see here on this video the URL for that. If you don't know what is this, go for it, check it. Please read after a bit. It's a really nice and smart solution for handling a lot of MIDI equipment in your studio, and you know, guys, I have a lot, so it's always a bit problematic for me to do a synchronization and use a couple of different MIDI interfaces and deal with the USB, and time to time one is out of the synchronization, so it's a really mess. Then I chose this protocol, this Copperlan protocol, to handle all of my MIDI connection. Because of that, I start to look on the internet, maybe there is real hardware and real devices which is using the Copperlan protocol. And I find one company, they called Alyseum. they're doing really interesting stuffs for the Copperlan protocol. Actually, they're doing a normal MIDI to Copperlan converters and interfaces, and also they're doing kind of analog to Copperlan devices, like you can send MIDI notes and MIDI values to your CV and voltage drive analog gears. Here you can see the URL for these guys, and I bought from them two units. One is the AL88C, I remember good, yeah? And the other is the Alex. And the AL88C, it's a 8 input and 8 output MIDI to Copperlan interface. And it's really work really nice and is not so costly. It's like 199 euro, including taxes and the shipping. They actually sent me the address of the shop, which is sitting here in Berlin, and they told me I can directly connect with them. I will get the products on a same price, but I will get here in Berlin, so I can jump to this shop and I can get it almost immediately. After a couple of days, I wrote an email to these guys, which company is actually the Schneidersleden.de. The URL is here. So I went to them, and a really nice, young, fresh company that dealing with really nice analog synthesizers. They're working in a labor to develop some kind of new things, and the guys, they are really great. Even if I just came for these really cheap products, they're fantastically friendly with me. They show me all the shop and all the other products, and all the even they show me some products which is under production. So really, if you are here in Berlin, go to them, go inside to the shop, ask some terminal or whatever, and look what they have. They're really great. So they give me this Alex and the AL88C. And this is what I will install now into this MV-8800 production studio. This small unit, it's really a smart solution. Look how small it is. Small like a box of match, and it's actually contain the one PIC32 CPU with the software inside, which is handled the Copperlan protocol and the Ethernet. And here on that side, you can see a really wide range DC to DC converter. And here is the connector where you can connect to your device inside. And actually here on that side, you just can see the brand name and the name of the product. And here is your Ethernet connector. And it has some couple of holes to fix inside in your synth. You install this into your synth, and then this convert all your MIDI signals which is coming in or coming out from your synth to Copperlan. And after you have the Ethernet connection, you just simply plug into your switch or to wireless system or whatever, and then you're done. You almost update the speed of the connectivity between your computer and between your synth magnitudes. It's contain one MIDI input and two MIDI output. which is of course is opposite on that one, because what you want to send is for your synth is input, and what is input on that is for your synth is output. So this is when it came really friendly with the MV8800 or also with the AKI MPCs or with the EMU X Turbo and kind of samplers, because those devices has one input and two output, or two input and two output. So really you can install this Alex into your MV and you can hold handle the MIDI, all of your MIDI IO. It's coming in a really small box, and they said send you this nice yellow page, which is nothing on it, just please visit our site for downloading the user manual and the cost-free Copperlan manager. By the way, this unit is the cost is like $80 or something like this. I don't think so it's so high cost for this kind of update. And they're also sending you all the necessary components, like a small jumper for configure even you want to use one IO or this one input two output, and a nice cut sheet for your instrument. So actually this is what I will use today to cut the hole on my extension plate on my MV8800. And they are sending for you this kind of cable, which is the power cable and the MIDI input and output cables. This is how it's coming, and now I will open the MV8800. I opened the back, the bottom of the MV8800. You have here the motherboard, and this is the main motherboard, which is contained the CPU and the memory and some kind of local power supply solution. This is some kind of cable which is running to the VGA input and outputs, and this is what is different from the MV8000, because in a MV8800 they installed this. And this is some kind of cable which is coming from the power supply unit, some kind of ribbon cables which is running to the CD writer and the reader. And as you see here, I already installed the solid state drive. You just have to take out this four screw, and then you have all this plate is coming out. And on this plate there is a very really nice Roland made rubberized support for your old HDD. By the way, this SSD is consume much more less power, and of course because there is no moving parts inside, it's I already get couple of dB much more less noise from the unit. I will open for you guys this power supply unit, because I want to show you what I did modification with the cooling fan. The power supply unit itself is contain really high quality capacitors and high quality transformers on a switching side, really big nice 105 degree graded capacitors, which is all of that of course is Nichicon branded. So actually what I find here inside, you see they also applied the high frequency filter on the cables which is coming out, but somewhile they put the additional panel for power supply of the display. And also here under this cable you can see here is this 5 volt to just let me unconnect the cables, because maybe then after you can see much more easier. It's contain this power converter, voltage converter, and this part is only for the fan, because actually the fan it's connected to that board by this connector. As you see here, the Roland put a high frequency filter before that panel. You see it's here, it's powered by this cable, and this cable is running into the device. So actually, after this high frequency filter, everything which is happening in here, it can come into your main board. So actually this is what I recognize when the fan is used, this 12 volt, somehow this DC to DC converter, it's generate for me really, really small noise, but really small. So maybe you guys even cannot recognize, but I'm really serious on these steps. So actually what I did, it's very simple. On a backside of this panel, there is one pin which is powering this DC to DC converter. I simply, with a really small and precise cutting, I cut the line, and I, of course, I ground it down to make sure nothing is came as noise into it from that other display lighting panel. And then after I simply connect these breadboard cables. You see it's a normal breadboard cables. I find here two holes, which is one is going to the ground and one is going to the 5 volt rail, which is actually powering this module here. And to that breadboard cables, I connected the original connector, and on this cable, I also installed. I also installed a small high frequency ferrite filter ring. So actually, now in an average. I did some kind of measure on my oscilloscope on AC on a really low voltages. I'm telling you guys now, I didn't get any big noise from this small panel. I don't know why Roland did that, why they're not applied into the power supply PCB at all. Maybe they just want to be sure this high voltage and this high frequency is not going directly on the same PCB where is the power supply unit, and maybe they want to change or replace this panel later on when they will develop more the display or something. But by a mistake or by not a mistake, they installed a 12 volt cooling fan, and they did here this very small nice job, but very small and a bit noisy DC to DC converter. So I installed here the positive, and somewhere in the middle you have the negative ground, and then you can connect back the original cooling fan to normal 5 volt. It's actually, now it's running really low power, low speed, but the speed is enough to carry the heat air from other parts of the MV-8800. That's all for the modification of the fan. It's really get really soft. There is no noise, no nothing. You have this extension port for add more. I think it's 8 input and 8 output or something like this, which is actually it's an additional panel, and you connect this extension to this connector. And well, no, I'm of course I'm not using this extension port, so this I will use in the future for hold my Alex my Alex PCB. As you see, it's a really small, like a piece of matchbox. So on the future, I will install this somewhere to here or I don't know. Maybe I have. No, I have. Unfortunately, I have on this original Roland brand printed on it. So maybe I will cut other piece of metal to that extension port, and on that metal I will install the Alex. So on the main board I don't have to touch nothing, but what you can see here, this is the MIDI I/O board, but unfortunately the opto isolator is sitting here. So actually this panel here, it's only for sorry guys, I have to move and rotate the camera a bit. So this panel, it's only hold the MIDI I/O ports, and there is just really small amount of resistors, capacitors for high frequency filtering, and nothing fancy is going on. And also on the bottom part of the PCB is really nothing, just really tiny parts on it. So two cable I can install after the last stage of buffer wart chip, but the input, I have to find the point after the opto coupler and this pull-up resistor, and here I have to do a cut. It's really, I don't wanna cut nothing in my Roland, but no other way to do it. So maybe later on I will do a small modification on the PCB I will install the jumper point to make this cutting much more nice, because later on if I want to sell my MV, I want to make sure everything is on a original stage. So let's find now this pull-up resistor and this optocoupler. This small black IC, this is the optocoupler. Now I'm touching the left leg, which is ground. Now I'm touching the other, which is the third one, and here is where the 5 volt is sitting. And now I will touch the third leg, sorry. And as you see here now, the MIDI, it's opened because nothing is attached to it. So let's attach something to the I/O. Okay, now I have a 5 volt, and if I put some drive voltage into it, you can see now it's open and closed. The third one is going to the power supply, and the middle one is going to somewhere as the MIDI input. Okay, let's do a bit more research. So for that, sorry guys, but I have to stop the video because I have to take out the whole motherboard. Okay, now, as you see, I released all the screws, which is here in the middle. One is on the back, another on the back, and one is on this side, and in this corner, it's this old-fashioned computer plastic stick on it. But unfortunately, after when you release all the screws from the motherboard, you cannot take out the panel because the potentiometers are actually are sitting on the main board. So you have to remove the caps of the potentiometers, and also you have to undo the screws which is hold the whole back plate, and you have to remove all the mother screws from the TRS connectors. So actually after that, if you bit loose this back plate, after then you can pull out the whole main board, which is actually looks like this. What a beautiful engineering is going on that. Really, it's really a high quality. I cannot expect anything else from the Roland. So now let's put this main board to the side for a moment. Here is the main board, and this is the connector for the all the MIDI I/O. And on a back side, if we are right, because this MIDI I/O, it's contain one MIDI input and two MIDI output. The green cable here is going to through this hole and through this resistor and some kind of coil and capacitor. It's going to that feed. These two point, it's actually, so this and this, it's the same. And these two is the data. These two leg, it's common, which is running a 5 volt. And these two are not common because this has to be independent from each. This is actually the data line of the MIDI outputs. And by the way, the MIDI definition, it's always saying the output has to be support 5 volt, and this other leg you have to switch on and switch back how your serial communication is running, and this is what is doing on a receiver side. This is how you close and open the other opto isolator. At the moment, I don't know where I connect, before the filter or after the filter. I think is best after the filter, because this resistor, it can be protect my output stage of the UART IC. Here there is a small drawing which is provided by the Alyseum company. They are really smart, I think. They give you the draw of your Alex, and if you print out this document in black and white, you can go by count one by one to left to right which cable is going to where. So actually it's really simple. The first cable is the ground. The second one, which is red, the red is going to the line of the UART chip, because this is when the trick is coming. So actually, when your MIDI in signal is coming into your device, it's actually going through the Alex, and also Alex can generate MIDI messages through that cable, but of course it has to be do some kind of mixing or bypassing all this MIDI communication here. So actually the original MIDI signal can come to here, and this is how it's coming into the Alex, and from the Alex is going to your Copperlan, and from your Copperlan you can send the MIDI signals to your synthesizer. And actually the second cable, which is red, why they choose the red, it's also really smart, because it's really has to, you have to be careful. The third cable, you have to connect your second MIDI output, and the fourth cable, you have to connect your first MIDI output connector. Then the fifth one, you have to connect to this pull-up resistor after your optocoupler, and the last one is which is going to the your power supply rail. I have really simply job to do. I have to connect the first one, which is the ground, somewhere on a ground plate. I can find a lot of ground. Actually, whole this whole PCB part it's ground. And on that panel, I solved the MIDI out 1 and the MIDI out 2, which is that cable. Here you can see this is the second one, this is the first one. And then I just have to install these two cable, which is the fifth one, which is the green, and the red into the board of the main board. And also for the main board, I will find some place where I can install some kind of old deep pin holder. So now I will switch off the camera. I will install here some kind of connector. So let me do on that way. Okay, I find the best place for the power supply of the Alyseum Alex. It's actually from the Roland power supply here on the connector 19, which is coming from the power supply unit. This second one from the bottom, this is the 5 volt positive, which is the same what I used to supply the cooling fan. And this is actually on inside in a board, and on that side, blah 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 blah, it's coming to this point, as you see. So actually the 5 volt is coming to this capacitor, and from this capacitor there is a few kind of local voltage regulation is going on, which is feeding the output 5 volt. And by the way, why I don't want to connect to the 5 volt on a MIDI cable, it's very simple, because in the Roland they are using one transistor current limiting solution, which is really just one transistor and one small resistor to limit the current of the 5 volt. So I don't want to bother this circuit. So actually I will connect the power supply for the Alex to here, because this is my 5 volt rail, which is coming directly from the power supply unit. So this on the Roland board, if you want to modify the Roland board, it's sitting nearly the MIDI connector, and the name is capacitor 20, so C20. I already did some kind of research on a panel which signal is going to where. So actually the Alyseum company say, if you want to connect the Alex panel, you have to connect the fifth leg to the point where the opto isolator output and the pull-up resistor is meet in the point. And the second one, which is the red cable, you have to connect directly into your UART chip input. But on the Roland MV, they not installed after the opto isolator. So they planned to make sure all the signal until it's coming to the UART chip, is if it's affected with some kind of ripple on a square wave voltages, So when it's arrived to the UR chip, they actually put this pull-up resistor closest to the UART input chip as they can. I couldn't find here any pull-up resistor close to this opto-isolator. This line is coming to here, and under the panel on the other side is going somewhere here, and then it's coming across these points. Unfortunately, under the on the other side of the panel, it's coming under the UART chip, and from this point under in the UART chip is coming directly to the leg of input. From this point up to back to the opto isolator, there is no pull-up resistor, and what they did, they installed this 10k kilo ohm resistor bridge here as a pull-up resistor bank. You can see here it has four 10k resistor inside, another four 10k which is coming to this side, and in the middle you have two connector which is pulled up to the 5 watts. So let's check it, make sure it's true. By the way, it's just a small tip. So when I'm when I'm looking back on any kind of instruments or computer or panel or something like this, I definitely using the Fluke 87V multimeter, because on the Fluke 87V you can choose for the conductivity tester what is the range where it's working. Why it's so important? Because if you have a cheapy multimeter, you can choose the range where the conductivity tester is working. Let me show you what's the difference between the voltage ranges when you do a conductivity testing. So here is the multimeter which is do a testing, this shortcut testing, and the other multimeter will be read for you the voltages. So let's now attach this to here, and as you see, it's 7 volt. So nowadays a lot of CPUs and any digital ICs, they're using 3.3 volt or even less than 1 volt on a digital inputs. And you see, this is the normal what you can get with normal no-name multimeter, but with the Fluke 87V on the lowest ohm range you get 7 volt, which is enough to light up LED even. But if you change to 6 kilo ohm, it's dropping the voltage drastically. So actually it's current limited. So as you see now, I just touch with my finger and the voltage is dropping drastically. Now we are on a 600 kilo ohm, and I just will touch, and you can see it's almost almost going to almost zero. Let's jump back to the normal 600 ohm range. Nothing. And this is the position, the 600 ohm, where you can kill easily your digital inputs on any part. So the full checkback on this Roland MV I did on a 60 kilo ohm range. So let's now check, I jump back to the 60 kilo ohm range. So let's check this line, what I'm saying is true or not. So this is actually the output of the isolator, and if I come in here, I get 0k. Sorry guys, you cannot see, but maybe like this, yes. Okay, so if I coming from here to this resistor bank, the first leg of this resistor bank, I get it's showing me I am on the same line. So this is why I don't want to go now on the other side and come back and blah, blah, blah. What's the problem with that? Here is the problem. The signal is coming under middle somewhere the UR chip, and on that point is coming up to this side of the PCB, and on this side of the PCB is connecting to the MIDI input leg of the UR chip, and from the MIDI input leg is coming to this 10K pull-up resistance. By the way, here is the the drawing of this resistor bank, how it's configured. Actually, there is one middle line. Here you can find the 5-volt power supply rail, and you have 8 resistor inside, which is connected to other legs or even other devices to make the TTL pull-up. The problem is the Alyseum Alex has to be connected to this point, but after you have to cut the line, and the other cable, which is the second one, you have to connect to the UART chip. So it's meaning you have to do by logically, you have to do by logically something like this. So logically you have to disconnect this here and the second leg is going to the input of the UR chip, so the second one you have to connect across these other legs, you have to connect to here. This is the problem because this distance here on a panel is really just 1 millimeter, and of course on 1 millimeter you cannot solder this size of, let me show you guys how it's compared to the size of the leg of the CPU, of this UART CPU. If I put here this red cable, what I have to connect, you can see it's almost impossible to connect here. So what I will do, let me zoom in a bit. This leg, which is coming to here, it's so tiny, this distance is just 3 millimeter or something like this. And this resistor block is even smaller than a dig of pie, or I don't know. So actually somehow you have to connect here, but you cannot because the signal is running under the UART CPU. So what we will do, I will desolder this small resistor block, and I will apply here the pull-up resistor in that point. And I will disconnect this leg from the panel. So actually I didn't cut nothing on the Roland panel. I just will pull up this leg, the middle one. So after when I pull it up, I will install one resistor to here. And to this point, I will connect the Alex input leg. And underneath, when I have this unsoldered part pad, this is where I will connect the leg from the Alyseum Alex. So actually, make you sure really understand this. By the way, on the end I will make some kind of high resolution photos about the modification. So here you can see this small black optoisolator. So I will pull up this leg. I will do here the resistor, which is pulling up the output of this optoisolator, and from there this is the fifth leg of the Alex, and this is the second leg of the Alex. So the fifth leg I have to connect to the pull-up resistor, like this, so you can see, and the second leg I will connect to here. And because here I also will do a resistor disconnection, so this pull-up resistor will be go nowhere. And I have a really cheapy technique how I can do with this small sorry, my finger again get a lot of dust because I really am working on a construction all the day. So what will happen? This line after that will become direct connection to your UART, and I will not cut any line on the original PCB on the Roland. And because this pull-up resistor is not connected anymore to this leg, so this will never become like 5K together pulling up. So it will be stay on a 10K, because here I have the 10K, and here I just have a normal line which is connecting to the UART MIDI input, and from there it's not going to nowhere. So that's it what I will do. And now I will do this modification. I will solder everything rightly on a panel, and then I will create some kind of high resolution photo, and I will share on the end of the video about the parts numbers of the Roland panel. So again, I'm putting back here the original panel. So again, what I will do, I will pull up this leg, the middle one, I will pull up from the panel. Here I will connect the 10K resistor, and under the pad which is can be free, this is where I will connect the Alex second cable, which is the red. So the power will become here, the ground can become anywhere, you can find a lot of ground plate, but actually I will connect the ground to the MIDI I/O, because it will be on the same on the same ground level. I will not have any ground lifting issue. So actually the other jobs are really simple. I will connect here and to here the two MIDI output from the Alex board. So one will become here, the other will become here. Why I choose? Because you can see here this this cable, actually the first one is coming to this leg. I don't wanna turn it again. The second one is coming to here, which is the second MIDI output. This is the first MIDI output and this is the second one. So the second cable here is coming to this leg. The third cable is containing a 5 volt for the MIDI connector, but I will not touch this. And I also don't have to touch here these two other cables, because this is what is going to the input of the opto isolator. So here I don't have to do nothing. So actually I can really do a nice job on the connection, because all the Alex connectors is come one to here, the other will become to here. A third one, which is the ground, will become on a ground plate of this PCB. The power will become to this C20 capacitor. The second leg of the Alex board will become on a free pad to the original PCB. And the fifth leg from the Alex will become here to the opto isolator output, and the opto isolator output will be pulled up with the 10K resistor. So it's really everything will be happen in this 3 centimeters. So let's do now. Until that, I will switch off the camera and we will come back when I finish the this part, and then we'll jump with the video about how I will modify this resistor bank close to this Roland the war chip. So yeah, now it's soldering time. I want to do a modification without touching the original structure on the original PCBs. So for that, to make sure, I will create some kind of solution, which is really, really simple. I just take few legs from this old tip connector bank. Oh, I don't know how it's called in English, sorry guys. So I just take few pins from that, and I cleaning down the, and I'm cleaning down the legs from this plastic or whatever, so until I just get the pins inside, which is contain a very nice pin on one end, and the other end you get the other hole. Maybe you cannot see like this. So actually this is what I get after. This is one leg where I have to connect one of the cable of the Alex, and this one is the other one which is coming to here across some filtering on other side. Okay. It's not so bad, it's not so big. I think it's enough as ground, but let me check if it's really connecting to the ground. So here is my ground, here is my channel 2. Which is now is showing me 200 ohm because of this filter solution here, so 200 ohm, and this is my channel 1. This is again like 200 ohm, nice. So on that panel I done with the modification. By the way, why I'm doing this? Because after a simple can use my breadboard cables even to connect to the pins. You see that? Really stable and nicely sitting in this deep connector. So let me show you again. So here I connected. Of course I will cut a bit shorter this cable, but on that way I can replace the cables, I can disconnect it, I can do measurements on it, I can put here one cable to the ground, and I can measure all the current which is eating by the Alex. So actually this is always how I doing this small level bodging or modification on a synth. So this is how I made it. Later on I will clean up this sheet. Let's do the same on the motherboard. Okay, now I will do this pulling up of this middle leg, but for do a nice job I have to completely disorder this small puppy here, and when it's free I can turn the leg up to here, and then I can soldering back, and then I can apply this pull-up resistor. For the next step, but now I have to tilt up this middle leg, and for that I'm using this small tip. If I'm lucky, okay, start to bending. By the way, I don't wanna break this leg, so I just really gently moving up. So as you see, now the middle leg, maybe it's not focused. Okay, here you can see now this middle leg, it's lifted up. So if I turn, you can see this is the ground, this is the data, and this is the power. So now I can solder back to the original place, and then I have one leg which is lifted up. The most important part, because here on a Roland UART, do you remember for this issue about this resistor block, create the pull-up voltage for the MIDI input in the Roland UART chip. This is how it looks inside, and this is how the resistors are connected in the IC. And you see here is where the 5 volt is coming, and this is the pin outputs which is on a PCB. It looks like this. This is going somewhere. This is the 5 volt, and this additional pins that are doing some kind of other pull up on other ICs, maybe on this same Roland UART. This is the line which is coming under the UART chip, and what we have to do, we have to disconnect this leg from this resistor, because we made this resistor here, and this resistor block is so tiny, it's like 2 millimeters multiply maybe 4 millimeter, not bigger. Here in this small half hole, so I don't know how it's called, this is where the metallic surface is created. So actually the solder, it can come to here and to here, and of course into this half hole. So, and here I don't want to cut nothing on a PCB, and this is also like 1.2 millimeter, not more. And as you see, it's really not easy to modify it. So what I did, it's a very old trick I learned from the age when I learned repair video and television stuffs. And in the tuners, we time to time we have to modify the key F frequency, or I don't know how it's called in English. We have to modify something always in the tuner box. So we always take off these resistor blocks, and with this pencil, which is a normal permanent maker pencil, we put one layer, two layer, three layer, more, four, five, six, whatever, until the thickness of this ink is achieved, like, I don't know how much, but actually the solder is don't wanna stick to that. So this is what I made also on this Roland PCB. I paint a couple of times this, I wait a bit until it's dry, and again I applied more. And also on the resistor block, because if you rotate this and you put this, you can see the pin 8 is coming to here, and the pin 1 is coming to the pin 1 is coming to here, and 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So I also applied a very tiny amount here to make sure the solder is actually not floating into this direction. So after that, I turn it. I put some really small, tiny amount of solders here, and then I just put here back this resistor block, and then I came with the hot air pistol and a tiny bit of pressure with this really really sharp pin, I don't know how it's called. It's by the way, this is a really nice tool. I really like it. If you see this brand on eBay, they are selling this actually in a set like for $20 or something like this. Go for it, because this, as you see, it's ESD protected. So all this surface, it's protecting all of your electronics from your ESD electric shocks. So with this tool, I applied a tiny bit of pressure, and I came with the hot air, and then by itself, by a physics, these small solders here, it's sucked in this resistor block. Here I disconnected the pull-up resistor from this pin, and this is how I made. So, but I don't want to make a video on it, because I have to work so closely and under magnifier, so I cannot make the video from the work. But here you can see it's really clean job, and maybe you can see here the remains from this permanent marker pen. I did a precise measurement on each leg, because I draw it down where these tiny cables are going on a PCB. So I did a measure one by one, and everything is okay. Only just this leg is not connected. in every my synth and my gear, I always put a note what I did modification. So actually this paper will be packed in into the case, and then when I just have to open it, and I, then I can see what's going on here. So yeah, this is why I left. By the way, it's, as you see, it's a really clean rework, because I have this kind of really super flux. It's a really high quality flux, and then of course I cleaned all of my work area with isopropanol alcohol, also here and also on other side. And by the way, I want to show you guys the other body modification. From the top you cannot see, but actually this is the lifted up leg here, and this is the pull-up resistor, and I also applied this same deep pinhole to that until I will not finish the testing and the measures and the checking with the oscilloscope. And here I installed the red cable. This line is actually totally same, which is coming under here. It's just running on the other side. So here I installed this pin solution, and the other end of this resistor is going to the 5-volt rail, which is also supply the power for the Alex PCB. That's it. This is how it looks now, and of course I will install everything back into the MV tomorrow, and I will organize all these cables into some kind of nice tubes or whatever, and then the Alex this one is coming to here, and that's it. I finished. By the way, the MIDI IO is coming to here. This is the original Roland backplate for the not used extension slot, and I'm really lucky because Roland did this on the rack size, and I have a lot of piece from this rack cover plate, because I in the past I've used a lot of servers and video servers and file servers and whatever. So actually it's completely exactly the same size. So I just did the drawing to here. I cut one piece of metal like this. I did the holes. I drilled other holes for this connector, and that's it. Basically, I didn't touch the original Roland backplate. So later on, if I want to sell it, it's of course it will be a total original shape. And this is the new backplate with the Alyseum Alex installed in. By the way, make sure when you cut this hole, you're watching which one is the top and which one is the bottom, because it can be ugly if you are not following the directions. And the Roland backplate, this hose is not in a center. So here you can see maybe more. You see this hole is not actually in the center. So when you copy the size and the plate, make sure you are not doing a mirroring, because if you do a mirroring, you will get some issue of the position of the hole. So you have to make a copy, a drawing exactly like face, not face to face, but face to back. So that's it. Now I will put everything together, and I hope everything will work, and And I think I did a really, really interesting job with this Roland MV-8800. So yeah, it looks to me done. So I just have to reassemble everything, and tomorrow I will show you guys how this Alyseum protocol is working. So catch you tomorrow.